Joining us on the phone, Dr. Brandon Brock, really to talk this week about how CTE and brain injuries related to NFL football has sort of been brought to the forefront. For the first time, the league seems to not connect the two, but at least acknowledge that it exists and it's maybe in the same realm. Good morning, Dr. Brock. How are you?
I'm great. Good morning. Thanks for having me on.
So what is this week change and kind of the perception? I feel like people are talking about it.
Yeah, me too.
A long time, it was there's no relation. It's just a coincidence. Where are we now in terms of diagnosis or going forward? I know some of the safety parameters have changed.
Well, really, right now the NFL has a big problem because the scientific information is now exceeding just their opinion.
Yeah.
So, and that's a big, big deal. They're kind of having to say, well, I guess it does exist. And really what you're probably going to see is they're going to acknowledge it, embrace it, and then say, if you play it, it's your problem now. That's what I think that they'll probably do. And they'll put the onus on the patient or the player. But as far as diagnosing it, it's still hard to diagnose. It's still one of those things that starts after their football career typically has ended. And it's not an immediate deal. I mean, the concussion or the head injury may be immediate, but then it looks like it heals up, but then the symptoms kind of go on and there's inflammation and the brain deteriorates. And then maybe a decade or two decades later, which is still not that old in a professional football player's, you know, lifespan, they start having significant signs of deterioration of their brain and they all of a sudden don't do well. And this is way more, I mean, you know, you only hear little bits and pieces of it in the media, but let me say this, behind closed doors, a lot of players are experiencing symptoms that they just do not like.
Yeah, I would imagine so. And, you know, being football, being a male sport primarily, I mean, my God, for years it has been, they're not going to run around talking about their symptoms either. So let me ask you, okay, so in Louisiana, you know, it's like, you know, Friday Night Lights, right? So we love Friday Night Football. How do you think the ongoing information that continues to come out about this, the scientifically based information, do you think that's going to have an impact for parents? And are they going to think twice before they let their kids join the football team, do you think?
Well, of course they are. I mean, when you have educated people that have kids that just want to, you know, most of the time football is not something that somebody's doing to launch a professional career. We all know this. It's a social activity. It's a way to be collegial with your friends and stuff like that. So, but parents are still sort of like, you know what? There's other sports out there. There's sports that we know are less dangerous. All sports can have their possibility of head injury. I mean, baseball can do it and soccer can do it and all kinds of stuff. But the chances are lower. The probability is lower. So what I think you'll see parents do is say, look, I want you to be sociable. I want you to be with your friends. But what I would like for you to do is to do a sport that has a lower probability of creating something that's going to affect your capacity to go to college or have a relationship or to live a healthy, full life and see your grandkids. I mean, these are things that are fundamental. I think most people get it now. It's kind of like smoking.
Yeah.
At first, it's like, hey, we didn't really know about it. Now everybody knows. You smoke too much, you get cancer.
Yeah, yeah. So let me ask you this from the standpoint of what the symptoms may be. You know, do they start with, like, erratic behavior usually? Is it a change overall in the personality? Or is that kind of specific to each individual?
Well, it's definitely specific to each individual, but there's some things that we can say are consistent. Number one, moodiness can definitely, in a lot of the patients that I've seen, you just think about it. If you can't remember how to get to where you're supposed to go or you don't remember small things, you're going to get a little moody just because it's frightening.
Yeah.
And then you've got brain injury on top of that, which makes you even moodier possibly. And then you don't sleep well. And then you can't hold down relationships. And then you can't executively function, meaning run your day.
Mm-hmm.
You can't sit there and say, I've got to do these five things. I got to do them in this order and this is why. Everything starts to fall apart from a higher level of function. And so people have to simplify their lives. And that's not what a lot of these guys want to do. They've got non-for-profits or they've got other ventures that they're trying to accomplish. And they can't do it because they just can't do it.
Yeah, that's certainly true. Well, Dr. Brandon Brock has been our guest here today. Sir, thank you so much for talking about the issue with us, because I think you're absolutely right. You know, the science, unfortunately, or fortunately now, you know, it's outweighing the opinion. You know, everybody down here, we love football. We love, you know, NFL football. But at the same time, you know, here are the facts, and the facts are the facts. So, sir, thank you very much.
You bet. Y'all have a great day.
You too.
829 now at News Talk 96.5 KPL.